We've been here for a month. It's been really amazing. I'm very fortunate that I got the opportunity to come here. I just got really interested. I thought it would be a good opportunity. Since I'm an anthro major, nice way to kind of put all the skills that I learned in class into action.
Because that doesn't look as calcified very well.
My name is Travis Pickering. I'm a professor of anthropology at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Today we're at Swartkrans Cave, which is one of the most important sites for the study of human evolution. We're in the heart of an area called the Cradle of Humankind, which is a broad area and that includes a bunch of cave sites, and Swartkrans is probably one of the most important of those sites. Part of what I wanted to do as a professor is not just give instruction in the classroom, but actually bring people to these areas in the world where fossils are being found to show them the evidence firsthand, to have them appreciate what that evidence is like to hold, to study, to curate, to analyze, just to give them an appreciation that we're connected to the natural world and we have this evolutionary record just like other animals, other organisms. That's what's exciting about Swartkrans. We have the fossils, which tell us a lot about anatomy, how big these things were, their body size, how males and females were different from one another, what they ate potentially when we look at their teeth, when we look at their skulls. But also, we can get even deeper into behavior because we have such a rich archaeological record here.
Oh, look at this one.
Oh, wow.
That's nice, right?
Whoa, that's awesome.
Wow. Hey, Kathy.
Oh, that's a nice one. You found a prize.
Yeah.
We only have one tiny point tip until now.
My name is Kathleen Kuhlman. I'm a Stone Age archaeologist. It's not just holding their bones and trying to interpret who they are physically. It's understanding their use of the landscape, their selection of rocks, the way they work the rocks, the behavior behind it all. So you're really getting a glimpse into their minds when you study the early stone tools.
Congratulations, Anissa.
Thank you.
Wow.
It was right here.
It's so sharp.
It's really nice, huh? Like it was made yesterday.
Yeah.
One of the most important things to me is situating ourselves in the natural world, understanding and appreciating that we are part of the natural world and we have an evolutionary history just like every other organism that we share this planet with.
This was dug completely by Wisconsin students, yeah.
And then sometimes you get little bone fragments of megafauna.
The undergrads at UW-Madison participate in this field school are adding to our knowledge of human evolution. That's a remarkable thing to me. And I know they carry the message of Swartkrans beyond the field school. We have to appreciate where we come from.
This is a rising star property, and it's very close to Swartkrans, Sterkfontein, these caves that are really well known for fossil sites. But these other properties nearby also have caves on them. And no one had ever identified fossils in this cave. But in 2013, Steve Tucker, Rick Hunter, they were real skinny guys and could get into the very narrow passages of caves. And they went exploring in caves. And Steve went into a crack, noticed that he didn't feel the bottom of it, wondered what was at the bottom, slid his way down, and at the bottom were fossils. And that was how the first discovery was made here. That chamber, when we worked here in 2013, would produce more than 1,500 fossil specimens of hominins. It was the largest discovery that ever been made on this continent, one of the biggest ever in the world. And we found that it was a new species, something we hadn't identified before. We named it Homo Naledi. That work just carries on. You know, we're still working in the cave. There are thousands of bones left underground. The most important thing that we've learned in the last couple of years about Homo Naledi is its age. You know, when we found the fossils, it looks like a very primitive form of our genus. We sort of thought they looked the most like things that are maybe 2 million years old. It turns out that these fossils are between 230,000 and 330,000 years ago. And that, to most of our field, has just been a complete surprise. This is something that was very primitive, that was very different from us in its, you know, probably social behavior, but at the same time, it looks like it's depositing its dead in this cave, right? So there's something very sophisticated about its social behavior. You know, this is really a fascinating puzzle, and putting it in that time period has shifted the way that we think about our origins.
Is it a big one? My name is Ronald Clark, and Swartkrans has been of great significance in the development of my career over the past 65 years. Yeah, this is going nicely. One of the main reasons to learn about our ancestry is that we are humans. We are unique in the animal kingdom in that we are the only animals that ask questions about our environment. How, why, where, when, all aspects of environment, including outer space. And this is called science. When you're asking a question, that is science. How, what, where, when. And one of the questions we ask is, how did we come to be human? How is it that we're different from the animals? And so we want to go back in the past and see when and where and how we diverged from the rest of the animal kingdom.
And then the other deposit that we've worked with through UW is this deposit here. I've read all Ron Clark's papers, all Kathy Kuhman's papers, and I was intrigued with what they were telling me about human evolution. To actually be able to come to South Africa and not just meet those people, but to work with them and be part of the team that they're on has been an amazing privilege.
Is where that beautiful Paranthropus mandible, SK23, came out.
So the epitome of my association with Ron Clark has been realized now that I'm part of the team that's analyzing the Littlefoot skeleton, which is the most complete Australopithecus skeleton ever found. This is a resting spot of the Littlefoot skeleton. It's no longer in the ground. It's been taken out, but this is where the skeleton was found. It's uncomfortable to have to lay on this surface as you're excavating, but you can see what a difficult sort of excavation this was for those guys.
This is a cast of the area in the cave. We molded it and we cast it.
There's plenty of other skeletons that have been called nearly complete, things like Lucy and the Sidiba skeletons. But in comparison to Littlefoot, they're not nearly as complete. And what that will allow us to do is to finally present a fully formed story and narrative of the anatomy and adaptations of these animals as a genus.
The head of the femur is still in the socket of the pelvis.
We have not just a skull and not just bits of the body, but we have a full skull and we have a complete body. And that allows us to develop a full picture of this organism's biology.
It's not really that little. It was quite a tough, hulking individual. It was about this high.
So this is a really rare case in the time period that we're talking about, almost 4 million years ago. The way forward is just brightly lit because of the completeness of the skeleton.
So it's an extraordinary occurrence and a very lucky find.
When you see something in a museum like that, you take for granted that it looks so put together and so well done, but there's a lot of work and a lot of thinking and discretion that goes into putting a skeleton together like that.
I've been able to clean in here now and exposed.
The teeth are looking good, yeah.
Even every single little evolving trait is incredibly important.
Still a beautiful face, though.
Yeah, it is.
Just to know why we are the way that we are, from, you know, our opposable thumbs to our complex minds, which came a lot later. I think it's the only way to understand at a fundamental level how human beings created the world that we live in.
We're at Marapen. This is the visitor center of the World Heritage Site here, the Cradle of Humankind. And we're outside the new exhibit of Homo Naledi. For me, it's an emotional experience to come into this and realize that, you know, this is stuff that we didn't know about 4 years ago. And now everybody in the world who comes to visit this can see these original fossils for themselves and get that experience.
I've been noticing you while I was standing outside.
Yes, of course. It's just so much fun to see people engaging with this, connecting to it. I've stood in here and watched as people come through, you know, school groups, and they're just chattering and excited to see the bones.
This is the largest fossil hominid exhibit that's ever been staged in the world. So take your time, but if you guys have questions, I'll be happy to answer some.
What does that mean, much more primitive?
But also people who are coming through and they've traveled here from Europe, from the United States.
Thank you.
And they're experiencing this African heritage that connects them to this place. It's just amazing.
Can you tell whether they died or...
We're all different from each other. And there's no characteristic that you can point at and say, everyone in the world has that. There's no genetic thing that everyone in the world has. There's no physical thing that everyone in the world has. If you just look and see, what is it that all of us have in common? The one thing that defines us as humans, it is this history, this common heritage. We've come from a story. And it's up to us from the science side to identify what that story is, and to come to an appreciation of those factors that all of us have come from, because that shared heritage is what we all will have in common going to the future.